Good morning, UUSS. Please rise in body or spirit to sing with us. Come sing a song with me, number 346.
Good morning. Good morning. It's good to be here. Welcome to our Sunday service. Whether you're with us online or you're here in person, we are glad you're here. I'm Roger Jones, and I'm happy to serve here at UUSS as one of the ministers, along with my colleague, the Reverend Lucy Bunch. She is leading our annual poetry service today entitled Poetry of Hope, along with our worship associate, Dawn Huebner. Our musicians, Anthony and Irina, are happy today to welcome back our guest soloist, who is soprano Oleksandra Sabashta. Welcome. The Ukrainian title of the gift of music that Oleksandra will be singing a little bit later refers to a traditional shirt which a young woman is making, embroidering for her beloved with hope for their future together. Welcome, Oleksandra. The mission of this congregation says we come together to deepen our lives and be a force for healing in the world. Toward this end, we honor the Nishanan, Southern Maidu, and Miwok peoples for their commitment to this land where UUSS exists. They have never left nor ceased to care for this land. In this time, in this country, this time of tension and hope, it is good for us to come together in community. So we hope that you will join us after the service for coffee and conversation. If you're already too anxious today and you don't need any more caffeine, we will have plenty of decaf coffee and herbal tea to choose from. And we have soup. Today is another Soup Sunday. Our cooks and servers today are from the Board of Trustees and the partners in their families that they have volunteered to make soup and serve soup. All ages are invited to stay for soup, bread, and a cookie. There's no set cost, but a voluntary donation is welcome. So after this service, when we have soup, if you go out this door, you go to the left and you swing around the hallway there, back there, and come down the hallway, you come out here, and as you wait in the line, you'll see on a whiteboard the menu for the soups available today. And you can get acquainted over soup in the welcome hall, on the patio, and in tables in the back of this room. If you are new to UUSS, we extend a special welcome to you. Please fill out a newcomer's card using either the link on our website or filling it out at the welcome table after the service. That'll help us connect with you. Our weekly message comes to you by email every Friday afternoon, and you can find previous ones on the website. For newcomers in particular, for next Sunday after the service is our monthly newcomers orientation with a tour of the campus. Your guide will meet you at the welcome table next Sunday at 11:45, and there's childcare available during the orientation, and it lasts until about 1 o'clock. Once a month, we offer a session before the service entitled Exploring Unitarian Universalism. And for those of you who may find it hard to attend a Sunday morning class here in person, we will repeat the class on Zoom, and I will be doing the first one. I will be leading Exploring UUism this Tuesday evening on the topic of our UU history and theology. It will start at 7 p.m., and you log into it the same way you log into a service on Zoom, and all are welcome. If you'd like to follow the music and other parts of the order of service, you may click on the link in the Zoom chat or look on the website. The blue sheet today includes a lot of upcoming events, and I believe it's in everybody's order of service, but it's clickable on the website and on the link. And these are just a few highlights from the blue sheet. Tomorrow morning at 10 on Zoom, Joanne Anglin leads reading and reflecting on a poem. On Saturday morning on campus, Reverend Lucy and friends lead the new session called Soul Collage here at 10:30. Our service auction is this coming Saturday afternoon from 4 to 6 p.m. with hearty appetizers, beverages, raffle baskets, and a live auction, as well as a 50-50 cash drawing. It is our fall flamingo, and we're excited about it. The auction team says there's still a few tickets available through the end of the day, and the table is out there on the patio. Our silent auction is live now and online all this week. It has 100 outings, events, meals, and services, plus opportunities to donate to our flock funds and our Fund a Need project. You can find out more at uuss.org/auction, or you can stop at the pink table and talk to one of the people dressed in pink to find out about it, or to sign up for one of the remaining volunteer slots for the event. Now, please check your cell phones to be sure they're on silent mode and that all the alarms are off, so that we can all be more present and mindful in the service. And if a neighbor's device goes off during the service, please be kind and help them in solving the problem. And if you're attending by Zoom, after the service, we will have 22 minutes of conversation in a smaller breakout room so you can get acquainted and you can offer reflections on the service. In the next few moments, you are invited to come forward here or here to light a candle of joy, sorrow, gratitude, or hope. And we have extra candles today. We thought more of you might be called to light candles of hope. And if you fill out a prayer card during the music for centering, that will enable you to let the ministers know of your news and also let us know whether it may be included in the spoken joys and sorrows today. Now let us receive the music for centering.
Thank you. Our cellist later today is Diana. The Soul Matters theme for the month of November is repair. And these words come from the Reverend Angela Herrera. Don't leave your broken heart at the door. Bring it to the altar of life. Don't leave your anger behind. It has high standards and the world needs vision. Bring them with you, and your joy and your passion. Bring your loving and your courage and your conviction. Bring your need for healing and your power to heal. There is work to do, and you have all that you need to do it, right here in this room.
This time, I'd like to welcome all who are going forth for youth activities, whether they be adults or youth, as we guide you in singing your song. You gotta put one foot in front of the other and lead with the foot.
One foot in front of the other and lead with the foot. lead with love.
It's so good to be together. Good morning, everybody. I want to share with you some of the joys and sorrows that are held in the hearts of people in our community. I shared with you a couple of weeks ago the passing of Sherry Boyle, a member of this congregation. Her memorial service will be on Friday, November 22nd at 10:30 p.m. in the Foz Room, and contributions in her memory may be made to the Sacramento SPCA. We've also learned recently of the passing of Clay Nelson over a year ago in Auckland, New Zealand. He was one of the office managers for us. Many of you people may remember him. Peter and Lou Bishop are celebrating their 42nd anniversary on November 7th, and Lou would like us all to know that Peter will be out of town. I think that means she wants us to take her out to dinner. Is that what you're going for there, Lou? Jenny Gwine shares that her beloved Uncle Austin passed away last week at the age of 82, and that she and Michael will miss his warmth and humor, and they're grateful that he is no longer suffering. Peter Hart shared that he's been accepted as a doctoral candidate at California Coast University into an educational doctorate in organization and leadership. And Frankie shares that after a massive stroke and 6 months in many hospitals and rehab centers, her friend Stuart is finally back in his own home, and that they are grateful to have him with us and back home. And on our cards this morning, Matt Nelsenador, a recent person with our congregation, but a longtime member of the Unitarian Universalist Community Church, is sharing with us that his wife, Rose, also a member of the other congregation, which is now a part of us, passed away this weekend. And he's asking for hugs. He says, hugs from all are welcome. So those of you who know Matt can start the hugs, and then that'll lead to a hug chain of other folks. Sue Ann's joy is, oh, I get what Sue Ann's joy is. Okay, I got a different pile for those, Sue Ann. Mackenzie is sharing a joy about the end of Día de los Muertos and the celebrations and the holiday season and being able to be surrounded by family, excited to eat and spend time with them. Sally Wilkins wants to thank all who sent cards, good wishes, and food while she healed from dog bites, hospitalization, and a wrenched knee. Oh my God, glad you're better. Fenn is sharing that their sister was diagnosed with lymphoma at 24, and they asked for healing and grounding energy for her as she starts chemo alone across the country. Meg is sharing the good news that Esma Sadat, the refugee dad, one of our refugee families, dad of four little ones, started his new full-time job at the state of California. Yeah. Jessica shares with us that the universe has gifted her with the UU church community and labyrinth walks when she needed them the most. There were 14 people at the labyrinth this morning. Another among us is sharing that they finally purchased a Nintendo after having wanted one for a long time. Christiana is requesting prayers for Sarah Patton, who will be having outpatient surgery on Monday, prayers for her health and speedy recovery. Valerie is sharing a sorrow that she needs assistance because of poor health. And one among us is telling us that their cats are nice. They say, my cats are nice and they are strong. Mama says maybe more heavy than strong, but I'm going with strong. And we'll get to these in a minute. So in preparing for a time of prayer with you this morning, I looked over the prayers that I'd been sharing with you over the last probably 8 years. And I realized almost every single time I start with, in these dark days, in these troubled times. So I'm not going to do that this morning. I'm going to start with the words of Martin Luther King, what he told his followers. His followers who'd been in the civil rights movement, who'd been attacked, who'd been shot at, spit on, attacked by dogs, beaten with clubs. He said, don't let them make you hate them. Don't let them make you hate them. There is no hope in hate. There is no positive energy in hate. Do not let them make you hate them. So instead today, we're going to shift our energy a little bit to a broader horizon. I want us to think about what the future can hold for us. So I invite you into a little bit of a visualization for what is possible with our country and what all of our whole body hopes will be true. So I want you to settle into your chairs, and if you're comfortable closing your eyes, feel free to do so. And pick something that is very important on your heart that is a challenge in our world. Usually the thing that comes to your mind first is the one that needs your attention. Maybe it's homelessness, healthcare, environment, fascism, whatever it is, pick something. Now I want you to imagine what it would be like if your vision for transformation came true. Think of that long horizon. If that problem were fixed, if that problem were solved, what would it look like? What would it be like? Fill it in with details. Visualize it fully. Think about where you feel this in your body, this horizon of possibility, this what we could be. Where do you feel it in your body? Now imagine that vision and all those feelings come together in some sort of a token or a talisman. Some small thing that you can hold in your hand, maybe a ball of light, a gemstone. Perhaps it's a shell or a leaf. Choose whatever comes to you first and hold that in your hand. Now let's reach back, far back. All the generations behind us, almost like mountain ranges going back into history. And think of all of the people who have brought love and justice into this world, all the kind acts that have come forth. And now draw all that goodness, all that kindness down into your token. Let it glow with their energy. This token is your talisman to get you through what comes next. All the goodness and commitment from those in the past and all the dreams of what is possible for this country. Hold on to it. And let us pray. Holy Spirit of love, we need you now. Help us to feel your power in every cell of our bodies. Let the power of love shine in us and through us so that we may be a force for healing, a force for love. Grant us the strength to keep our heads up, our hearts opened, and our eyes fixed on the world that we dream about, the world that we know is possible. May love guide us, heal us, inspire us, and sustain us in all the days to come. Blessed be.
Please remain seated.
So this is our annual poetry service, and this year's theme is hope, chosen intentionally. You will hear three poems this morning and reflections on each of those poems. We will read the poem once before the reflection and once after. And in your order of service, you have a sheet that has the poems written so that if that is helpful to you, you can follow along. I also want to say that we don't have to be done with the candles today. If at any time during the service you feel a sense of hope or you feel the need for a sense of hope, feel free to get up and light a candle. People get up during the service all the time. I see it. So don't worry about the people sitting near you. They will be grateful that you're expressing hope by going out and lighting a candle. Let us begin.
Against Panic by Molly Fisk. You recall those times, I know you do, when the sun lifted its weight over a small rise to warm your face, when a parched day finally broke open. Real rain sluicing down the sidewalk, rattling city maples, and you so sure the end was here. Life, a house of cards tipped over, falling. Hope's last breath extinguished in a bitter wind. Oh, friend, search your memory again. Beauty and relief are still there, only sleeping.
So many spiritual writers and activists have made the point that hope is not a mood or a feeling so much as it is an orientation toward the world. Optimism, on the other hand, is a feeling. Optimism says things are looking up, but we know that things can slide back down. Optimism relies on our interpretation of the facts. Sometimes it relies on our denial of the facts. Hope, on the other hand, relies on our commitments. Even when faced with failure, uncertainty, or danger, hope is a choice of how to act. Hope is a decision to remember who we are and what we value. I think of panic, as in the title of the poem, I think of panic, whether personal panic or that of a whole community, as those moments when we forget so much of what we have been able to accomplish in the past, in spite of terrible odds. We forget how resourceful we can be as people and as communities. We no longer can see any way out, or we see only one way out, and we get locked into that view. In this moment of heightened emotions, it can feel so real. In moments of panic, we confuse our emotions with reality. We become unable to see a more varied landscape around us and ahead of us. We're not able to imagine or explore possibilities which are waiting within us and among us. We are not able to embody hope. The poem observes how easy it is to see life or the world as a house of cards tipped over, falling. It is worth noting, however, that the ways we base our lives on certainties are the ways that we make a house of cards for ourselves. When we are seduced into certainty, we are in an unstable place, an unreliable place. Perhaps instead we can build a structure of self and of community which is not a house of cards. Perhaps we can build a foundation of strength, connection, commitment, and joy for ourselves and for one another. In these times when so much is at stake about our future, there seems to be among many of us an expectation that we have to feel panic or despair in order to prove our commitment to the values we care about. Whether this expectation is real or whether we just take it upon ourselves, such panic does not build a sturdy house. It does not build a foundation to shelter us for the long haul. When we act on our values, we put panic in its place. We build hope through our actions. This poem against panic is not a poem of denial. It doesn't say, things really aren't so bad. Yet this poem is not a work of social analysis. It's not a strategy for action either. It's a reminder to ground ourselves in life, nature, joy, and gratitude. I read this poem out loud over the phone to a friend who lives way up in the northeast corner of this country. She could relate to its imagery and sense of the warm sun. Unlike the clear, sunny Sacramento Valley, she said, the land where she lives is a gray and chilly place for much of the year. Moreover, her house is down in a hollow. So when the sun does come out, to her it really seems to lift its weight over a small rise toward her face. When it happens, she said, This experience elicits from her a physical response of joy. When she feels the sun's warmth, she said, "I don't think about it. It's just a response that my body remembers." Hope requires our willingness to be surprised and to remember. While we cannot manage everything around us, we can manage ourselves. This doesn't mean berating ourselves or pushing ourselves to exhaustion. It means treating ourselves with kindness. In times of trouble and worry, being patient with ourselves can enable us to extend kindness and respect and patience to other people. Managing ourselves includes the practice of gratitude, giving thanks for our most basic blessings. It involves letting go of certainty and acknowledging all that we cannot control. While recognizing this, however, let us remind ourselves that all we cannot control includes moments of grace and beauty and surprise. To appreciate and celebrate what we have accomplished as individuals or as a country, is that a setup for despair? To appreciate those things? No, it's a reminder of what's possible. Gratitude reorients us toward hopeful action. Oh, friend, search your memory again. Beauty and relief are still there. The poet's words are like a gentle shower of water on our body, or a breeze touching our skin, or the sun's rays warming our face. It is like a deep inhale breath. It doesn't change anything out there, but it may help us in here. Another title of this poem could have been "Against the Certainty of Despair," or "Against Forgetting All That We Have Accomplished," or with a lot more words, it could be "Against neglecting the simple pleasures and ordinary beauty which make up so much of our days." In the presence of so much that could provoke us to panic, the poem asks us to remember our moments of peace and pleasure. Is it risky to give thanks for what we enjoy today because it could be gone? Is it a risk to feel joy? Is it a risk to laugh? No, it's a relief to do so. Here's the poem by Molly Fisk one more time. Against Panic. You recall those times, I know you do, when the sun lifted its weight over a small rise to warm your face. When a parched day finally broke open, real rain sluicing down the sidewalk, rattling city maples. And you, so sure the end was here. Life, a house of cards tipped over, falling. Hope's last breath extinguished in a bitter wind. Oh, friend, search your memory again. Beauty and relief are still there, only sleeping.
Thank you so much. We're blessed by your beauty, beautiful singing this morning. In my intro, I forgot to mention that I brought along an emotional support animal. It's very squishy. It's right here. And there's a whole basket of them out in the welcome hall. If you need one, Crystal Fountain would be happy to share. This poem is A House Called Tomorrow by Alberto Rios. You were not 15 or 12 or 17. You are 100 wild centuries and 15, bringing with you in every breath and in every step everyone who has come before you. All the yous that you have been, the mothers of your mother, the fathers of your father. If someone in your family tree was trouble, 100 were not. The bad do not win, not finally, no matter how loud they are. We simply would not be here if it were so. You were made fundamentally from the good. With this knowledge, you never march alone. You are the breaking news of the century. You are the good who has come forward through it all, even if so many days feel otherwise. But think, when you were a child, you learned to speak. It's not that you didn't know the words. It's that from the centuries, you knew so many, and it's hard to choose the words that will be your own. From those centuries, we humans beings bring with us the simple solutions and songs, the river bridges and star charts and song harmonies, all in service to a simple idea, that we can make a house called tomorrow. What we bring finally into the new day, every day, is ourselves, and that's all we need to start. That's everything we require to keep going. Look back only for as long as you must, then go forward into the history you will make. Be good, then better. Write books, cure disease, make us proud. Make yourself proud. And those who come before you, who came before you, when you hear thunder, hear it as their applause.
The bad do not win, not finally, no matter how loud they are. Those lines were the reasons I chose the poem you just heard for this service, a service about hope in the midst of fear. There's plenty to feel afraid of right now, and hope can feel elusive. There are times when the animosity swirling around us makes it hard to breathe. I know that feeling. It's what characterized my childhood. I was raised by someone very much like the Republican nominee. My mother never ran for public office, and we weren't nearly as wealthy, although she was awfully fond of gold. But the narcissism, that's what was the same. My mother insisted on two things, respect and adoration. I needed to show both at all times. And if I slipped, if she felt crossed or disrespected in any way, she became vicious, hurting me in ways that were both intentional and cruel. My father capitulated to my mother. He wasn't mean, just weak. And he sacrificed his children for the sake of his marriage and appearances. I'm not sure how I knew this, but by the time I was 12, it was clear to me that what I had to do was survive my childhood, to get to 18 and leave home. And I needed to do that without letting my mother destroy me. So that's what I did. I survived. scarred to be sure, but holding on to who I was, a person with my own thoughts and ideas and values, able to create, to give and receive love, to contribute to the good in the world. I know that it is possible to survive truly terrible things, to survive even if Tuesday doesn't go the way we want it to. I am, of course, hoping and praying and donating and working toward the outcome I want. I will be stunned and heartsick and bitterly disappointed if hate prevails. But I know that I am the good, we are the good, that has come forward. And the bad do not win, not finally, no matter how loud they are. A House Called Tomorrow by Albert Rios. You are not 15 or 12 or 17. You are 100 wild centuries and 15, bringing with you in every breath and in every step everyone who has come before you. All the yous that you have been, the mothers of your mother, the fathers of your father. If someone in your family tree was trouble, 100 were not. The bad do not win, not finally, no matter how loud they are. We simply would not be here if that were so. You are made fundamentally from the good. With this knowledge, you never march alone. You are the breaking news of the century. You are the good who has come forward through it all, even if so many days feel otherwise. But think, when you as a child learned to speak, it's not that you didn't know words. It's that from the centuries you knew so many, and it's hard to choose the words that will be your own. From those centuries, we human beings bring with us the simple solutions and songs, the river bridges and star charts and song harmonies, all in the service to a simple idea, that we can make a house called tomorrow, that we bring finally into the new day, every day, what we bring is ourselves, and that's all we need to start. That's everything we require to keep going. Look back only for as long as you must, then go forward into the history you will make. Be good, then better. Write books, cure disease. Make us proud. Make yourself proud. And those who came before you, when you hear thunder, hear it as their applause.
Generosity is a spiritual practice, and this congregation has a practice of giving away half of every Sunday's offering, half of the non-pledge contributions, to an organization that is working to make a difference in the world. And our community partner for this month of November is the Sacramento Native American Health Center. The center is committed to providing a culturally competent, holistic, and patient-centered continuum of care. There are no tribal or ethnic requirements to receive care at the center, and it plays a major role as part of the safety net in the Sacramento area, where Medi-Cal benefits leave many people with little or no access to mainstream health care. Thank you for your support to UUSS and our community partner.
This morning's offering will now be given and received. As Lauren and Karen bring our offerings forward, please join with me in our shared response. May generosity bless our world, and may gratitude nourish our spirits.
Our final poem is called Calling to You by Steve Garnas Holmes. Sit before the ocean and take in how it reaches out to you over and over. Notice how the wind moves through you, making space for you. The silence of the morning includes you. The wildflowers in the pasture welcome your looking. The evening breeze moves in and out of you with comfortable familiarity. Strangers in the street carry their wounds and dreams in heavy plastic bags, not knowing what they're waiting for. Beyond the wall are broken hearts with room for you. The noise of the city is not mindless, but pleading. Hear the world calling to you, neither an emperor nor a beggar, but a lover, a spouse, calling you to come home, to complete what longs to be whole.
When I chose to do this poetry service about hope, I first thought about using a Mary Oliver poem. After all, she is the patron saint of Unitarian Universalists. but it didn't seem like really what we needed right now. Her poems are nature-based, and that didn't feel like the right frame that I wanted to use speaking about hope. Now, please don't get me wrong, I am a dyed-in-the-wool pagan. Earth-based spirituality is my jam. Connection to nature is what stabilizes me, nurtures me, inspires me. The cycles of the season give me hope for transformation, for new growth arising out of the depth of winter. I actually have plenty of hope for our Earth. I don't need to work on that at all. I believe that the Earth and all of nature will do just fine when human beings put ourselves out of extinction. The Earth will heal, the ecosystems will restore themselves, the planets will not even notice, and the universe will go on expanding. We are but a blip. It's the hope for humanity that I'm struggling with. So along comes this poem, Calling to You. We used it in our Soul Matters group last month and spent quite a lot of time. We did a Lectio Divina, where you read it three times with a different frame of reference each time. And I think maybe the agreement in my group was that it's rather a deceptive poem. It starts out like a Mary Oliver poem. There's the ocean, the wildflowers, the evening breeze, everything's welcoming you. It's beautiful, it's comforting. And then suddenly these strangers come in. They're carrying heavy plastic bags filled with wounds and dreams. There's broken hearts beyond a wall. The noise of the city is pleading. What the hell? Many people in my Soul Matters group felt like they were totally set up by this poem. They said it was two poems, the nice one and the ugly one. They never really got to the last stanza because they were so upset by the third stanza. Some of them thought that the people with the heavy plastic bags represented the homeless, and that took them to a place of powerlessness and despair. They did not find it to be an uplifting poem. Now, despite these challenges, I really have to give the poet credit. The plastic bag thing is so evocative. Envision it, heavy plastic bag, awkward to carry, burdensome. The noise of the city is not mindless, but pleading. Very evocative words. So the more I reflected on this poem, I started to understand why it's called Calling You. I started seeing it as more of an invitation. An invitation to engage deeply with humanity, with all its wounds, all its dreams, all its broken hearts, all its pleading. For here's the truth, my friends, my beloved friends, we all have heavy plastic bags holding our wounds and dreams. We all have our hearts broken. This poem says strangers, but you are a stranger to someone else. You have your own heavy plastic bag that is awkward to carry. None of us know what we're waiting for. Maybe we're waiting for each other. So this is where the hope starts to break in for me. Being human means knowing suffering, pain, but knowing love and nurture. This is how we are connected through our shared humanity. And this is how we will save each other. Those of you who have been with us for a while probably remember my ministry of the greeting. I try to greet everyone who comes along my path, whether I'm walking, riding my bike, circulating around. And sometimes I get to make eye contact with a stranger. This is a tremendous source of hope for me. It's like, I see you, other human. I know you're there. We're in this together. When I was in seminary, I had quite a convoluted way to get from Sacramento to the Bay Area, including a car, a walk, a train, and BART for the last leg going into Berkeley. I was on BART that morning in January when Obama was being inaugurated. It was a fairly crowded train. Many of us were standing. Someone had a computer, and he had the inauguration playing on the computer. Obama was giving his speech. It was a magical moment. People crowded around to watch. But what I remember most was that many of us exchanged glances with each other, total strangers exchanging glances of excitement and hope. It felt electric. Look what's happening, we seem to be saying to each other. See what's possible. Can you believe it? I will never forget that moment. Obama talked a lot about hope, but more than his words, it was the exchange of glances with those strangers that electrified my hope for our country and opened my heart to possibility. Strangers in the street carry their wounds and dreams in heavy plastic bags, not knowing what they're waiting for. Maybe we're waiting for each other to put down our bags, to share our wounds, to dream, to connect, to encourage, to create, to love. The poet says, "Hear the world calling to you, neither an emperor nor a beggar, but a lover, a spouse, calling to you to come home, to complete what longs to be whole." We all share this longing for wholeness, a longing for connection, all of us. There is nothing more powerful to the human psyche, and nothing more hopeful. This gift we give each other, human to human. People say in love relationships, "Oh, he completes me." You can say that for anyone. My connection to humanity is what completes me. My connection to humanity is what gives me hope. Being human means knowing suffering and pain, but it also means knowing love and nurture. This is how we are connected, through our shared humanity, our shared longing for wholeness. And this is how we will save each other. Calling to You by Steve Garness Holmes. Sit before the ocean and take in how it reaches out to you over and over. Notice how the wind moves around you, making space for you. The silence of the morning includes you. The wild flowers in the pasture welcome your looking. The evening breeze moves in and out of you with comfortable familiarity. Strangers in the street carry their wounds and dreams in heavy plastic bags, not knowing what they're waiting for. Beyond the wall are broken hearts with room for you. The noise of the city is not mindless, but pleading. Hear the world calling to you, neither an emperor nor a beggar, but a lover, a spouse, calling you to come home, to complete what longs to be whole.
With hope in our spirits, let's sing "My Life Flows On" in endless song.
My life flows on in endless song, a mother's lamentation. I hear the real, though far off, hymn that is a
Prepare to extinguish the chalice. Please join me in speaking our shared intention. We extinguish this flame, but we carry the light, love, and commitment of this gathering into the days to come.
Let us reach out to each other. Reach out with hope to our world, to our communities, to all those that long for wholeness and connection. Don't keep from singing. Promise me you'll sing. Promise me you will keep your eyes lifted up on that horizon, that dream of what is possible. You will keep your eyes lifted away from doom-scrolling election results. Promise me you will do that and keep that talisman that you created. Keep it, hold it, know it represents all the love in the past and all the possibilities in the future. Blessed be.